Hello, everyone, and welcome to the third event in our series, Your Path to Farm Transition. I'm Patty Durand, and I'm a business advisor with FCC, and I'm excited to be here with you today. I will ask you to note that it is not an accident that this nine-part event series is called Your Path to Farm Transition. As our team has met with hundreds of farm families, we appreciate that many of you are looking for the right way to transition your family farm, as though it's a single path with one route. You have shown us each farm is unique, therefore your transition will at some level be one of a kind. In our last event, business advisors Andrea DeGroot and Corey Henderson talked about how to begin to tally up and assess the current financial state of your farm business. Now that you know where you are right now, today we're going to focus on clearly describing where your farm business and family is going in the future. Is everyone on the same page with your farm transition? Let's talk about values, vision, and goals. I am really pleased today to be joined by Kent Goulash. Kent is a Royal Roads Certified Executive Coach that supports families in digging deep into their opportunities and challenges to develop a path forward. Welcome, Kent.
Good afternoon.
How's it going, Kat? Friend?
It's going well. How are you today?
I am so happy to be doing this with you. This is something that I know means a lot to both of us. And so coming together is a big deal. I personally am really looking forward to hearing and having you share some of your experiences in terms of helping farm families kind of get more clear on where they're going. Can you remind me how long you've worked in the agriculture industry?
Do I have to put it in years or can I just use decades? It's been it's almost 40 years since I started working in the ag sector, working with producers at a variety of levels. A lot of it was agronomic, and it transitioned over time to a different relationship with many of them, and one that has led me to bringing a focus towards this whole area of transition and succession planning.
That is, it's a big deal. And I think about between the two of us, we have, you know, 65 combined years of working in the agriculture industry. And so if we can share some of the tidbits of what we've learned, but also what we've just begun to understand, I think that'll be a great day. So we do have a poll, and I'm hoping we can see some results here. We talked about what everybody's goal was. I'm just going to have a look here. So 38% of you say that you'd like to learn three new things. Thank you. We hope that we offer those nuggets. And so if you're open to that, listen for them, and we'll do our best to offer them up. To have the opportunity to list values, visions, and goals. A third of you, 33%, said that was something you'd like to accomplish today. And 28% said you'd like to learn how to start the conversation about this planning. So we commit that we will do our best to make that happen. And zero, not one person said they're doing this to pass time during harvest. Thank you for committing to that. Thank you for spending time with us and helping us to just making this a priority, because we know it to be important, but only you can take the bull by the horns. So before I spend more time talking to Kent, I really want to set the scene and really think about why is setting values, vision, and goals often a missing piece of planning for farms? And if I can just have the slide on the screen, please. As I sat with a mom and dad who were in their 50s a few years ago, I was asking questions to explore each person's hopes and dreams for their future and for the transition of their farm. And I really like the visual of thinking about this view of the mountains, where the close-up mountains range there is more clear, the details are more clear in the picture, but as you move further and further out, it gets a little foggy, it's not as clear, and planning for the future can be very much like that. When we were talking, the mom shared, she said, our son keeps confidently sharing that his future vision for the farm is that he wants to grow it to be the largest farm in Canada. And she really wanted to be encouraging, but she wondered out loud, doesn't he want to have a family life? How will that impact our retirement? Would that really be successful? This is just one example of hundreds of farm families where future vision, expectations, and plans aren't lined up, often because they're not verbalized. So how do you get it lined up? When you think about this vision, looking out into the mountain range, the key is to begin and to continue conversations, talking about it, sharing and asking questions, being curious. Today, I'm going to ask you to take some notes because Kent is going to share some great questions that he uses to help people to unpack what their hopes are and where they're aiming, and you can use them too. Too often, farm family members think they're aiming for the same goal when they actually haven't compared or discussed. Sometimes someone's aiming for this mountain peak. Another person's aiming for the one slightly over. So it seems similar. It feels the same, but it's not quite lined up. And sometimes someone's over in left field. We have this opportunity to have a conversation and see how far apart we are and discuss how we might get closer. Sometimes figuring out long-term plans and values and vision is tricky because different team members on your farm have different approaches. Does this sound familiar? Sorry, I scrolled ahead. So this picture, the mom who is so meticulously focused on the tiny details right in front of her that there's some big issues getting missed. Or perhaps the brother that is so busy with day-to-day operations, the longer-term goals never get the needed time to plan. Or what about the cousin thinking about the new ventures 5 years down the road and implementing plans without consulting with the rest of the team? Or maybe the dad so concerned with past mistakes that they fail to see the new opportunities and options right in front of them in the current market. These isn't labeling specific people, but rather saying that this actually does happen. People can get kind of hooked on different things. And we have this opportunity to ask great questions and help get all on the same page. So thinking about future and plans for your farm family, the poll asks you to rate on a scale of 10, where does your farm family present and future plans line up? So if you can let us know, that would be really helpful for us to understand where you're feeling and where you think that you might want to be improving. So Kent, this is our opportunity to just have a chat with the two of us to share some of our learnings and understandings and hopefully shed some light on it for the people who are watching today. From your experience, why would a farm family choose to spend time figuring out their shared values, vision, and goals?
I think it's one word, Patty. It's alignment. It's understanding where everyone is sitting from a standpoint of what they want versus what you want. Values ground you on that common way of being. How you're going to act with each other, how you're going to behave in situations of working together. But it creates a harmonious state with the family when there's connectedness on that. Vision is a very interesting one. It's a powerful word, and it's kind of daunting at times. But if farm families can wrap themselves around that of looking forward and getting pointed in the same direction, it makes it easier to move together. And then goals are just magical things. They're not hard to do, but they're hard to commit to. A lot of people have goals, but they haven't taken those goals and put them in a referenceable place. And I think we can spend some time talking about that today.
Absolutely. So those are some specifics in terms of those three points that we're going to be visiting. But in terms of why, as an overall, why would you do that? Something that I know you and I have talked about is the efficiency that gets gained when you're pulling in the same direction. Can you comment on that?
Oh, for sure. Let's go back to the initial image you threw up. You don't have to go back to it, but the one of the scenes of the mountains. No, our day-to-day is what's in the foreground. It's what we can see that's mapped out pretty well in front of us, the things we need to do, as producers and as a farming family to get through this year. But if we don't sit and talk about which peak we're pointing at on the mountain, if we don't bring those arrows together and bring our energies towards that, there's going to be moments where we're working against each other. There's going to be moments when we're working on things that are counterproductive towards each other. You're going to be using a lot of energy up throughout the year and every day that's not going to be contributing to moving the operation forward.
You just said something I just want to hone in on, and in terms of not necessarily doing the things all in the same direction, I think kind of that friction. The outcome of spending some time on this can be saving relationships.
Oh, for sure.
I will even offer that you and I spent quite a bit of time before part of this event, right? Like, let's make sure we're pulling in the same direction. What does that look like? What would a good outcome look like? So we really want to lead by example. And it's challenging us to make sure that we're being held accountable and saying, yeah, we're not just preaching it, we're actually doing it. One other thing that you commented on, and I just, I think it was really powerful. You described it as shifting the farm lens from I to we.
Well, that's in farm family coaching. That's a lot of what we talk about is the key understanding of who is doing what. What are the roles? What are the responsibilities? And how do we connect as a family team? Connecting as a family team is a lot different than connecting as a family. But getting towards that piece of, we use the words pulling in the same direction and moving away from I, if we get alignment, if we get together on where we're going, on what our vision is, how we're going to work together, what our values are, what we need to accomplish as our key milestones to move us towards the future. And we'll talk more about vision as we go ahead, but the vision always continues to move. It's not like we set that at one point in time and it becomes a journey of days, months, and years, and we're there. It's going to re-evolve. It's going to reset itself in time. So we need to keep coming back to it and keep moving those proverbial goalposts. But that we connectedness is a part of what comes out of that, and it's building a foundation for good, common conversation about what we're doing, why we're doing it, how we're going to do it, and who's going to do what to move things ahead.
You said something really important. I just want to hone in on it. And this was brought to my attention and comment from another business advisor on our team, that the other place that people might have heard some of this language around values, vision, and goals is often around like nonprofit organizations and volunteer boards. And there's sometimes a bit of a bad taste left in people's mouths when there's been time spent on this planning and then the outcomes don't happen. And so if that is your story, I'm going to ask you to set that aside and say, you know what, we're going to give this a fresh start and a new look and make this work for our family. And so just know that this is never, as Kent just described, this is never decided as chiseled in stone. This isn't something that is a once and done. It is a practice, and if something's revisited and you do it together, and it's really powerful as a result. So thank you for that explanation, Kent. We have some poll results here. So on a scale of 1 to 10, we asked, rate your farm family's present and future plans in terms of how it's being approached. And it looks as though kind of the majority is kind of in the median, where some people, about 16% feel like a 4 out of 10. So they're have more than zero plans, but they've got some ways to go. And all the way up to, I think a peak is at about 5. So generally people are making attempts at this. There's some planning. There's been some conversations around it, or at minimum, there's some goals that have been set, but it's a beginning. And this is a learned practice. This is not necessarily something that what effectively got your farm to today's state often was really an individual or at most a couple of people that got you to the state. As you're thinking about transitioning and involving more people, it really does require that habit of coming to the table if you really want to light it up and do it as best as possible. Okay, so we've done the persuasion, Kent. We've convinced the people. They've showed up today. They said, okay, we're going to give this a try. We're going to begin with values. Start us off. What are values?
I like to refer to values as the guiding principles that apply to your farm family business. When you come together, how are you going to act? How are you going to behave? And they become non-negotiables, but also show a high level of respect towards each other. you know, understanding what's important to me from a value might be different than what's important to you. But taking the time as a family to bring them out, talk about them, not just define the values. Values are quite often defined in a single word or represented in a single word, but that single word can have a different definition for everybody. So once values are identified, creating definition around them, and then to take them, to make them real, it's to identify what the behaviors are going to be. So for any given value, there needs to be a set of behaviors that we're going to wrap ourselves around and agree that that's how we're going to be. It sets a higher level of presence with each other. It also helps to really define how you work through things when everything is going well, but how you work through situations when they're tougher, because you understand each other at a deeper level.
Okay, Kent, that was water from a fire hose. That was a lot. It was really, really good, but we're going to break it back down again. So the definition of values, I heard you say they're non-negotiable guiding principles.
Right.
So, but someone would have that as an individual, and you can have those as a team as well?
Certainly. You know, my personal values port across to everything that I do. You know, an example is integrity for me. That's a value I hold very high. I have my own definition of integrity, but when I ground truth it with behaviors, I talk about being truthful. I talk about being reliable. I talk about being authentic. And I talk about being accountable. That's what builds my value of integrity.
Excellent. So then in turn, what happens if a value is compromised? If you hit a nerve with someone and it happens to be one of their values?
If it's an agreement that's established within the team, within the farm family, it gives that point of going back, permissively going back and saying, hey, remember when we talked about this and we talked about this as a way we're going to be and an important value to us? What's going on with you right now? What's happening right now that it feels like this isn't happening? You know, another value might be open communication. Suddenly I'm feeling as a member of this team, there's stuff going on that I'm not aware of. What's happened to the communication?
So it becomes a touchstone for that conflict resolution you referred to.
Conflict resolution, even forward planning, decision-making, you know, that's a different time and a different place, but these values really start to represent the things that we're going to agree on. Touch the proverbial cloth, so to speak, and say, yeah, this is how we're going to be with each other, how we're going to act, and how we're going to show up when we work together in this farm family business.
I think the phrase that you would use that really was sticky for me is an opportunity to define the common ground we share. So it's very foundational. It's very early and can equip other planning.
It does. And it's really the foundation on which you're going to move to the next step of creating your vision and in turn developing your goals. You know, if this piece isn't in place, it's like building a house without a good foundation. Eventually one corner is going to fall away. Eventually something's going to slip away. But if you can come back to these things, it's got utility in a whole bunch of situations. Whether it's one-on-one within the farm family, whether it's when you all get together as a group, it's not a bad thing to put up. It's not a bad thing to talk about with frequency, because it's not like if you talk about it once, it's there. If you remind yourself towards them, they'll become a lot more relevant, a lot more real. You become a lot more grounded.
Okay. So you just said values as in them. So let's dig a little deeper into what values, because I think that actually some of the words around it could be really helpful. So what are some ways that you approach it in terms of when you're figuring out a farm family's values?
I like to approach this early, and particularly when I like to approach this is when we get to that stage of the family meeting, when we come together for the first time in through transition planning. And this is a tool from Farm Family Coaches that we use as a part of that meeting. Hand this out to everyone and have them take a look at these words. Put it up on the screen. Look at these words and then really reflect on them and say, what resonates with you? So regardless how many people there are in the room, the way I like to approach it is we probably can connect to every one of these words and say they mean something to me. Pick five. Pick four or five that really become your non-negotiables. Which of these words are you not going to give up on? Which of these words are so important to you in your day-to-day that you think they've got applicability in working together, you know, as a family? I did this very recently with a family that was in a very proactive state of transition planning. And the one word that came up that created, was two words, but it created a bond in that family that energized the entire meeting was have fun. And it suddenly became safe. It became very safe for everyone to say, we can have fun and still run this business and grow this business. But by getting everyone to go through that and identify their words, they narrowed it down as a family to five words that they could align on that meant something, took it to that state of each of them creating their own definition. And then we defined some behaviors out. It became a very rich, exercise for them. Maybe 45 minutes total. But since then, I've heard back from them. They've sent me their values map that they've created for themselves that's up in the shop. It's on the wall. It's also in the house. They can pull it out of their drawer. They try to avoid now doing their meetings at that place of eating, and they put a table out in the shop instead. Have different dynamic, but this is that reminder of, hey, how are we going to be when we're with each other? So there's lots of different ways of doing this.
As you describe that, Ken, I have to be honest, that moment when the family was like, oh, like here's the common bond, it gave me goosebumps. Like that is a big deal to be able to find that, those spots where they're you know, aligned, where they're all on the same page. Can you tell, you talk about behaviors. So what behaviors were reflected? Can you share what behaviors reflect their core value of having fun?
So the one thing that one of the sons brought up is, it's okay to laugh at ourselves because we're going to make mistakes and we're going to learn from mistakes. So let's not be afraid to laugh at ourselves. As we plan our weeks and months, let's make sure we take time to do our own things or do some things together. So they walked away with a quarterly plan of their own family team activities they're going to do to get away to make sure they build fun in. Nice. But when it came to the day-to-day, I think the most important one is, let's accept our mistakes, learn from them, and not be afraid to laugh them off.
It's a pretty good plan. It gives people some grace in the process too.
Yeah.
You commented about asking people what their values are. If someone, you know, even if they have the list, if they're struggling to narrow it down, what questions might you ask to help give them some perspective? Because like I could probably look at that list and say, yeah, like all of those are important to me. How can someone drill down on what really is like their most valued core values?
And that's probably a little bit of a bridge point opportunity to go between you as the individual, you as part of the farm family business, you as part of the team. So if you're looking at some of these and saying, well, I like all of them, I want all of them up there. Which ones are going to become more important now for the success of the farm family business? Which ones should we focus on and create definition? And everyone's got a bias. We all have a bias unconsciously to which one of these are most important. Maybe you can't do it in a one and done exercise. Maybe you have to look at this, put some thought into it, and do your own rank sorting and come back and say, okay, I attached myself to 12 or 15 of these, but now I've got to the point of saying these four or five are the most important. And the reason I stick on that number, Patty, is that if you make this a list of 10 or 12 or 15 values, it's going to become really challenging to ground yourself to it. you know, and some of the checks I use on that is go search out some of the companies that you do business with, that you enjoy doing business with. Go look at their websites and go and find their values. Majority of companies have their values and missions on there. Go see what their values are, see how they're defined them, and see how they're representing them. And it can give you a bit of a guidance to how do we approach this? How do we do it?
You also mentioned in our previous conversations about if someone's really kind of stuck in narrowing it down, asking them, what is something that brings you frustration or annoys you in the world? Can you expand on that?
Yeah, good one. A lot of times that's linked to the people that we deal with day to day in the way we do business inside and outside the organization you're in. So think of yourself as your own consumer. Think of those you deal with in business. What do you experience? Is it going into the parts counter and not being acknowledged? Is it phoning someone for information and being sloughed off? Is it not getting a response when you really need a response to something? What are the things that set you off, that frustrate you, that you can proactively look at and say, well, we don't want to be that way. I don't want to be seen that way. And I don't want to be experienced that way. So what behavior am I going to attach to that?
So then what behavior do you want to be known for? So if it's something that is something that you are aware it triggers you, typically the opposite or the positive side of that is the value that is kind of corresponding. Is that yes. Accurate to say? Okay.
Yeah,
so knowing that values can be, I mean, it's its own topic, right? This is a novel that could be written. We recognize that if you're just starting on this, you haven't really done this before, we are aware of a tool that could be helpful to you. And so it's being shared in the chat. There's a link to a values assessment tool. Now, this is it's a free resource that you can use on the internet, and it can be a place to start the conversation for yourself as an individual and perhaps share it with your farm family. So when we think about this being a bit daunting, here's a simple place to start. And it really does list some values that you can start to narrow those things down for yourself. So then, I think you've alluded to this, Kent. I'm just going to get you to just kind of maybe wrap this portion up by talking about, so the values are labeled, but then you said you want to define them amongst the family.
Absolutely. So it's taking it to the next stage of getting to a common definition, so to speak. So if I say teamwork, Patty, what does teamwork mean to you? Or if I take that around the table and I ask everyone, what does teamwork mean to you? What does responsibility mean to you? And a really nice way to approach this is not just start by putting somebody on the stage and going around the table and saying, what does it mean to you in the moment? Take pen and paper in hand. The value of responsibility. What does it mean to you? Write out a definition. Come back. Everybody share their definition. Ideally, put it up on the whiteboard. Put it up on a flip chart. Everybody should have a flip chart in their meeting room. Put all of the definitions up and then look at them. Ruminate on them a little bit. Come to a definition that lands for everybody. And that gives common understanding, because there are differences. The same word has very different meanings to different people. So it's that going one level deeper, going one layer deeper. Oh, we like responsibility as a value. If we just leave it at that, and there's 10 of us involved in the operation, or six, there's six different definitions. If we create that common definition.
So defining those bricks. Defining that foundation, forgive me, defining that foundation, those bricks of the foundation that everything else is going to be built upon. Here's where we come together, here's our common ground. So yeah. Then they've now narrowed down their values and the foundation is made, now on to vision. So done the values step. First, can you define vision for me?
It's that image of the future. It's an aspirational image of where you see the operation going in the future. And it's multidimensional. It can be size, whether that's acres or number of head of livestock, is one factor. The other factor is, can also include location, change of location, what the main yard might look like over time. It will also bring in who's going to be involved, how many people are going to be involved. Visions generally are a five-year timeline. We know where we are today. Where do we want to be in 5 years? What does it look like? Some visions are very well represented by words. Some visions are very well represented by images. And I like to give people permission to take a blank slate. Actually, I prefer to use, take a blank sheet of plywood and think of that as your canvas. Draw your picture of your future state. What's it going to look like? And don't worry about being an artist. Scratch it out as at whatever level as you can. But when you start putting some images and then attach some words to that, and a vision is that shot in time for the future. It's where do we want to go? And then in behind that comes everything of how do we move from where we are now to then. But the most important part of visioning is getting everybody aligned to one picture and seeing one picture in the same way. And that's the more challenging and arduous part of it.
Forgive me. If you encounter a family, which I would imagine would happen, is that, you know, this person has this vision and they've painted this picture on the plywood. I really like that illustration. They're painting this picture and describing it to everybody, and someone else has a completely different picture, or it appears quite different. How might someone manage that? How would a farm family talk through that?
Well, I'd call it a beautiful moment of revelation, because now we understand the difference in where they're at. So
those two mountain peaks.
Absolutely. And one person might say, you know what? I've been thinking this way, but your mountain looks a lot better than mine. And now I'm curious about it. Or they could be the other way. Or they could say, I really like your idea. What do you think of my idea? How can we bring those together? That's not bad if there's two people. If there's three or four or five and you're pointed at different peaks, that's going to become more challenging. So you find points of common ground, what that's going to look like, and use that as your starting point. And then you start figuring out what makes sense for all of us. What can we all buy into? What can we all support? And you work yourself through this slowly. Don't think that you have to just jump in and get to a vision in a matter of minutes or hours. It might take you a little bit of time, but use the resources that are out there. Let yourself go into this a little bit. It's some blue skying, and some of us are comfortable with blue skying and others aren't, because there is a little bit of, well, I can't predict the future. I'm not sure what it's going to look like. And that's okay. Accept that.
Well, I think what you described too,
picture.
Forgive me. I just think about what you're describing. Painting that picture is one thing. That picture might be a bit foggy, or it might be black and white, or it might not be very detailed. I also appreciate what you said about that this is something that might take some time, so doing it slowly. So giving everybody around the table a chance to digest what they've heard and say, okay, everybody's kind of shared their vision. We know that they're not quite on the same page. We're going to circle back in a week, in a month, in a quarter, next quarter, and see if we can get this closer. We agree that we want to do this together, so therefore we want to find a way. And it's that commitment that can really move some dirt.
Yeah. And share it and talk about it and reshare it and talk about it and reshape it until everybody can agree and say, that's it. That's the direction we want to go today. Okay. So the vision defines that aspirational future state forward from this point in time. Staying connected to the vision, large organizations have leaders that focus on keeping people connected to the vision on a daily basis. They bring it up often. They make it part of the conversation often. So same thing with your farm operation. When you shape a vision, come back to it, talk about it, refine it, make it relevant, make it what you want. There's a few farms out right now that are have launched their own websites, and they're sharing their vision. They're defining their purpose. They're putting it out there. They're worth exploring. They're worth looking at. They may give you some thought, but that's not your vision. Your vision has to come from in here. It has to be where you want to go. And if you're going to do that as a family, it has to be where you want to go as a family and serve everyone going forward.
Well, and it's an opportunity. I think that I really appreciate some of the questions you've shared with me before. So if you're asking people, an individual or, you know, a farm family team member to share their vision, can you give an example or two or three questions that you would ask to help them to express that?
Patty, I'm pretty blessed because I've been able to do this with several dozen farm families and organizations over time. And I've got a little bit of a recipe that works and helps people move forward, but starts off with what's your purpose? Why do you exist? So that's coming back to why are you here today? Farming, raising crops, raising livestock, doing whatever you do. What's got you here today and why do you exist is that? Where are you heading? And ultimately, what do you want to achieve? And it's okay to start reaching out there and putting those longer range quantitative and qualitative goals in place. 5 years out, we want to grow from X number of acres to Y. That could be doubling. That could be increasing by 50%. But putting a quantitative number on there helps to create that commonality of alignment for everybody. We're going to move from 5 to 7,500, 10 to 15,000. What's that going to take then? What's in behind that? The final one is what do you want to become? And is something you want to become greater than what you are today? Is it going to have a different, is it going to have a different feeling and meaning 5 years out? And 5 years is a microcosm of time. It's pretty short, but when we start thinking about where are we going to take the business in 5 years? It's okay to say this is hard and this is taking a lot of energy to do, but it's so worthwhile.
Yeah, you know what? You actually, that's a big deal. What you just said in terms of sometimes the answer is, I don't know. I don't know what I want. I don't know where I'm aiming. Mm-hmm. If that ask comes and that it is clear that this is impacting everybody else and we really want to all go in the same direction, that's a call to action in itself. Like only you can figure this out as an individual and then let's figure this out together as a team. So I really, that picture in the plywood, it's such a great visual. A family gets to the point where they have a nice full color or at least more clear picture on that piece of plywood. People understand what they want for the farm, what they want for their quality of life, how they want to be treated as a team. There's a lot of different aspects that can be described. Once that vision is more clear, it becomes kind of a filter of function. Every decision and choice can be tested. Does it line up with those values that we said were important, that we said as the top ones? Does it line up with that vision? And if not, why are we doing it? Does this task, does this decision actually line up with what we're actually said was important and that we valued? Can you share an example of a family that used values and vision to benefit their family and their farm? I think you have a few, but if you can share something that just to connect the dots here for us.
Yeah, I think in a lot of cases it's been what's allowed conversation to start to happen. By getting visions out, I've got one family I'm thinking of, by getting the visions on the table of all of the stakeholders. And I refer to it that way because there's the business aspect of the business, but it was of the farm, but it was the parents trying to sort things out with the kids, with the children that were involved in the farm and not involved in the farm. And it wasn't until we got the conversation started about what each of their visions was that the parents could start to wrap their minds around where we were thinking of taking this is radically different than what their expectations are, what their visions are. So it gave a moment to allow them to come, more than a moment, it gave them that pivotal strategic moment to be able to come together and have a conversation as a group in a very safe space to be able to say, hey, we have 2 out of 5 siblings that are currently involved in the farm and want to be involved in the farm. And now we've got a whole different, we have a whole different paradigm towards the future of what the 3 non-farming siblings are thinking and how this farm can be successful going forwards, what it can look like in 5 years, and what we'll be doing as the parents, what our succession will be, and the transition steps are going to be to that, which involved them being able to port themselves out of the farm over the time, look after their financial needs. And the interesting part was, pop the lid off of their bucket list of stuff that they'd been piling up over time they wanted to do. And they didn't know if they'd be able to, and they didn't know how they'd be able to it. But by being able to put those pieces together, they were able to start doing some of the things in that list with comfort, knowing that the farm was going to be able to move forward and they were going to have the support they needed.
So it removes the guesswork.
It was almost taboo for them to get together and have a conversation.
Yeah. What you just highlighted, we don't have to guess what everybody else is thinking. We can ask. We have this opportunity, and we fail to set aside time to do that. So at its very core, that's what this is. How you label it, whether it's values, vision, any of those things, it's actually like, let's talk about what this looks like. Are we going the same direction? Thank you for that example. I can feel myself in the chair at kitchen tables with those exact same conversations. And so this is not rare, but it's a great opportunity to open a door. So we have these values and vision, and we're going to talk a little bit about goals now and kind of the next step in working towards everybody pulling in that same direction. There's another poll. On a scale of 1 to 10, as you as an audience member, rate where you feel your farm family is on a goal setting spectrum. Do you set lots of goals? Do you set no goals? Where do you fall? So we have the picture on the piece of plywood. Can you first start off, when we think about wanting to work towards that vision, define what you view as a goal? What's your definition, Kent?
A goal is a measurable outcome. It's something you write down that you can measure. It may have a numeric value attached to it, or it may have a change attached to it, a qualitative value. And goals are commonly thrown in 2 buckets. Quantitative, there's a number. Qualitative, there's a measurable change in the organization, in getting towards the future, to what they want to do. That can be cultural, that can be operational, that can be organizational. So cultural things could really relate to how we see ourselves growing the culture of this farm business going forward, how we're going to be seen by those that we interact with and do business with. That's a cultural goal. And that can be a changing point for some farms, especially if they look in at some type of vertical integration. There could be lots of culture changes coming in the future. Operational goals, just how we're going to do things in the future. What changes we see from an equipment standpoint, from a processing standpoint, from processes we actually do on the farm, could be another one that comes into play when it comes to those qualitative goals. They're a little fuzzier every time, but they're just as important as the number ones.
Absolutely. So it's interesting. I think that of the 3 kind of general topics, values, vision, goals, I think that goals is probably the most accessible thing for most people in their day-to-day life. Like goal setting is kind of a kind of lingo that most people would use at some level. And in fact, I think on farms, there's lots of goals that are set. Like here's our bushel target. Here's our return per acre target. Here is our the goal that we have in terms of involving people. There's a number of things, but they're not necessarily spoken or documented anywhere. So when thinking about people and their goals, before I even look at the results, I suspect that this will be a higher number. People will generally be setting more goals. So let's have a look. So thinking about goal setting spectrum. So we do have about half of the farm. About a quarter of the farms feel like they're at a 5 out of 10 in terms of how well they set goals. Mm-hmm. But we have another quarter that says they're 8 out of 10. So I feel like it's a little more accessible. It's a little more familiar. But maybe we can say we can all do better. And that's actually a great example. A goal of do better doesn't meet your criteria. It doesn't meet your definition. It's not measurable. We can own it as a person, but it doesn't, how do we know when we get there? So how do you push someone to more clearly define their goals and then connect it to their vision? What order does that happen in?
So the goals support the milestones. If we have a vision of where we want to go, in order to get there, it's the journey. And there's stage gates that we need to reach to get to that vision. Recognizing that we likely will reset the vision before we actually achieve it, so that we keep ourselves forward looking and keep our eyes up. But those goals need to be attached to, if we want more acres, this year we're at this level, next year we're at that level. How are we gonna do that? What's our growth target in acres from this year to next year? If we're redefining our productivity goals, whether we look at that from a financial productivity, whether we look at that from a bushel productivity, or kilograms of milk, if that's what's relevant to you, then it's a matter of, okay, what exactly do we need to write down? And then we build a plan underneath that to support it. Goals need to be something that are specific, that we can look at and build around. They need to have a time component to them. Goals aren't endless in time. And Patty, I'm going to throw a question back to you, just with your permission.
Please.
Do you have goals?
I do.
Where are they?
I have them written in my journal, and I have them documented and review them. But I will also say that I have great aspirations to do a better job of it, and then I kind of get lazy over time. So I personally need to be reminded to revisit it, and I have to kind of create systems that focus me back on those goals, because I can get distracted by a lot of stuff. How about you?
I throw those questions up specifically because most people have goals. When I ask them where their goals are, their most common answer is to go like this. Oh, my goals are up here. Oh, that's great. Do they change from day to day and week to week? Sometimes. When we take goals and move them from here to onto paper, then they're in that state that they can be discussed with everybody in the family, with everybody in the business. They can become a point of conversation, and they also become something that's going to serve us very well in figuring out what do we need to do to achieve those goals. Setting goals for the sake of setting goals, but never achieving them, never putting together the work plan behind them to achieve them, is going to dissuade us. It's going to make us not want to set goals. Oh, why should I bother? Because I never hit my goals anyways. But when we make them more real by writing them down, by visiting them on a regular basis, by bringing them up and watching how those goals move the meter, so to speak. They become that barometer of success. Oh, look, we're moving towards our vision. And we're doing that because we're achieving our goals. That's the connectedness. The value support, everything we're going to do when we work together. But the goals are the things that we're actually going to do that's going to move us.
And the goal, when we talked about that filter of function, like, does this move the needle? Does this get us where we want to go? Does this actually, you know, check that box? And checking all of the tasks that we do on a daily basis, is this actually bringing us there? You talked, and we've spoken about this in terms of short and long-term goals. Can you tie that in with, so like you talked about a five-year vision, and then like where do those goals fit in, and how does that, by documenting them, how does that become such a powerful tool?
So I worked with a client that had, when they came to their vision was to double their acres in 5 years. So we talked about 3 years. In order to get to where you want to be, if doubling your acres in 5 years, where do you want to be in 3 years? They put a number there. And then I said 2 years. And then I said 1 year. And as they took and mapped that from where they were today, they had steps. They had stage gates in those acre growths to go from where they are today to 2x in 5 years. Very simple one. Sounds very easy. But as we get in underneath that now, that's where the planning comes in to get to the goal. What am I going to do to grow my acres by 25% this year, by another 25%, by 15, 15, and 10 to get me to that doubling? So they actually broke it down over that time span of what percent in growth each year in order to get me to double the acres. Then we started working inside that and putting the actual plan together to support getting to the goals. As a group, as a family.
That group, that family, that's the key, right? Is yeah. Like, oh my gosh, we all are in the loop. We all own this, know this. We're all aiming there. And again, that whole guesswork factor is removed. The other, a comparable, I would say the scenario that really comes to mind as you're describing that is I think about talking to a successor and wanting, and they want to be the lead decision maker in 5 years. Okay, what do you need to do in the next 5 years to prepare for that? What actions do you need to take? What courses do you need to take? What questions do you need to ask? Laying out those things to become their goals in order to reach that vision. It allows us to have a focus to get things done. And if we do that as a team, it is like exponentially powerful and way more fun.
And a really good opportunity when you get to that conversation as well is, you know, you're talking about the individual as the successor. Don't forget the founder in that equation. Somebody has got this operation to the state it is today. They've got the intellectual property. They've got the story of what they did, but they can play a really, really important role going forward as a mentor. And as we define roles and responsibilities going ahead in time, those founders can be very important if they want to play that role in helping that successor to move forward. And one of the roles could just be cheerleader. The other role could be teaching them the things they don't know or helping them in things that they're really good at. Or as I like to say is, a lot of those founders have superpowers. Can you take and use those superpowers over time and in essence build your own talent, capability, and what the founder was great at.
So speaking of encouragement, this is something that Kent and I have discussed extensively. We both feel really strongly this is something that farm families have the abilities to do on their own. They can dig into this and use resources and ask the questions and use the tools. However, it's also understandable that they may be seeking and craving a third party, a coach or advisor that can help them through this. And so when you reach a crossroads and you're not certain what to do, you want to get more clear on your values, vision, and goals, but you're really perhaps feeling like you're stuck, it's very reasonable to reach out for coaching and support. And so I guess, Kent, that is something that I know that you do. Do you want to comment on that? And when you're invited to a table, what value are you bringing?
So I'm bringing the value of curiosity, not the answers. Curiosity from a standpoint of understanding their situation. Presence in that I will ask questions and let people share what they're thinking. Let them hear what they're thinking. Because a lot of times this stuff stays bottled up. It's not talked about. So by being present with them and doing that, it lets them speak. I think the biggest thing we bring as a coach is we bring process. Help identify what you have got in place that's moving you into a transition state towards succession. And what do you have to get to next? What are those things that you've been putting off? What have you been putting off discussing, putting off doing, putting off getting involved in? Because you may have tried it. You may have used some of the resources that you folks have available, and you hit that one of, oh, this one feels hard, maybe a little hard. So I'm going to stop now. And you stop because it does feel hard. We play a big role of accountability. We work with clients. We help them to be accountable to themselves. We don't take the lift. We don't do the work they need to do, because that work means something when you do it for yourself. But by having that presence, by moving at the right pace for you, everyone's got their pace, but as long as we can identify that and work with them, it helps them to move things forward. And they may get to a point in their time when they say, hey, we've got this again, but we'll keep in touch. But a lot of times, because we create acceleration, they like that feeling.
So we are closing in on our hour of time. It has flown by. We do have a question here. It says, can you speak to moving goalposts? In a family dynamic, many experience a change in criterion when moving through life and while the transition of the operation is in progress. So the rules changed or the needs changed. Goal setting is hard. What can people do to revisit the process for goal setting when they're trying to change some of those goals or make adjustments on the fly?
So the value of a plan is a document. You can take that plan and open it with regularity and identify those moments where, you know, what I want has changed. My needs have changed. My aspirations have changed. Open that up, talk about it again, and redefine it. This is never cemented. It's never set in stone, and there needs to be that flex and give. And you don't want to hold someone in because of a decision made 2 years ago. If something changes situationally, keep the conversation going. Have your meetings. Have your family farm business meetings.
Well, and remind yourselves you're on the same team and permission to make some of those adjustments. Absolutely. So I need to put a wrap on this. Kent, it has been an absolute pleasure. Thank you for all of your knowledge and wisdom. And know that people are... you can do this alone, but if it's something that you need help with, that is a possibility as well. Thank you.
Thanks, Patty.
So we have more clarity for values, vision, and goals for your farm family. We've narrowed down the shared values that you all live and work by. Describe the future vision with a picture on some plywood and write down the goals needed to get to that vision. Ultimately, there's this opportunity to shift from this or this to this. It is possible. You can do this. We're going to be cheering you all the way. That does it for our time today. You'll receive a link to this recording in a few days. Please take time to rewatch this with your family and share so that everyone can look at their roles in the farm to support your transition planning. There will be a link to register for the entire series shared after the event, and I encourage you to watch them all. At the end, you will receive a special certificate for joining us for this entire series. If you can't make an event, don't worry. They'll be recorded and sent out to everyone registered and will be available on the FCC YouTube channel. You'll also receive an email shortly in your inbox with links to an event evaluation form. We take your feedback very seriously and care to do as good a job as possible. That's one of our goals. So please honor us by giving a response. Next up, my teammate Joel Bokenfor will be up on October the 11th, hosting a conversation focusing on building professional advisory teams for your farm, of which Kent is one example of a possibility. Successful farm transition planning is a team effort, and so know that you don't have to do this alone. On behalf of FCC, thank you for joining us today, and we wish you all the best as you find your pathway to farm transition. Take care.